My name is Kit Yates, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about my new book, The Maths of Life and Death. Now, I should be clear from the start that this is not a traditional maths book. There are no equations contained in the pages of the book, nor is it really a book for mathematicians. What it is, though, is a book about real people and their lives and the places where mathematics has had an impact, perhaps without them even realising it. So this might be people who've been given a dodgy medical test result because their doctor wasn't sufficiently mathematically trained to understand the results of a test. Or it might be people who've made a significant lifestyle choice based on a figure or a statistic that they've read in the newspapers, and it turns out that that statistic was actually spun. It wasn't the whole truth. Or it might be people who've been maligned by a mathematical miscarriage of justice because the expert witness who testified against them was an expert but not an expert in statistics or mathematics, and they got the figures all wrong. More than just telling people's stories, though, what I want to provide the reader with is a bunch of tips and tricks or hints and hacks which they can use to optimise their everyday lives in our increasingly quantitative society. So this might be anything from getting the best seat on the train to choosing the shortest queue at the supermarket. But the idea of the book is not just to hear the stories of people who've suffered mathematical tragedies, but to learn from those mistakes so that we aren't forced to live through them again in the future. Because sometimes mathematics really can be a matter of life and death. So I'd like to give you an example of one of the stories from the book in which maths has had an impact on people's lives. On the 22nd of May 2017, at around 10:30 in the evening in my hometown of Manchester, an Ariana Grande concert was finishing at the Manchester Arena. Parents were coming to the foyer of the arena to pick up their children, and children were streaming out of the concert hall to meet their parents who were coming to take them home. At the same time, Salman Abedi walked into the foyer of the arena with a rucksack which was filled with nails and screws and bolts and a lot of explosives, and he blew himself up. And he killed 22 innocent people that evening. Manchester is my hometown, so I followed news of this story particularly closely as it developed over the next few days. What I noticed as I leafed through the newspapers was a strange coincidence. Exactly 4 years earlier, on the 22nd of May 2013, Fusilier Lee Rigby had been brutally butchered outside his barracks in Woolwich in another Islamist terrorist attack. And I wasn't the only person to notice this coincidence. There was a headline in the Daily Star which read, "Dates matter to jihadis, Manchester Arena attack on Lee Rigby anniversary." In this article, the Daily Star were covering a tweet by President Trump's deputy assistant Sebastian Gorka which read, "Manchester explosion happens on 4th anniversary of the public murder of Fusilier Lee Rigby. Dates matter to jihadi terrorists." And I saw this headline and I thought, is this really true? Is it true that dates really matter to jihadi terrorists? Are they so organised that they can strike at will? Or is this a piece of propaganda designed to make us more scared of Islamist terrorists than we really should be in order to advance a particular agenda? So I decided that I was going to take a look at the maths of this situation. A really handy piece of maths that we can use to analyse this coincidence is called the birthday problem. The birthday problem is a mathematical thought experiment which asks, what's the probability that two people in a room share a birthday? Or to put it another way, how many people do we need to have in a room before the probability of two people sharing a birthday becomes more likely than not? The answer is surprisingly low, at just 23 people. There are 365 days in the year, so how can it be that with just 23 people in the room, the probability of two people sharing a birthday becomes more likely than not? To answer this question, we need to do a little bit of mathematics. It turns out that what's important is not explicitly the number of people in the room, but actually the number of pairs of people, because we're looking for two people to have the same birthday. So what we really want to find out is, when we've got 23 people in the room, how many pairs of people are there? Let's imagine taking 23 people in the room and thinking about the number of handshakes that those people can make, because this is going to tell us the number of pairs of people there are in the room. So let's start by lining them all up against the wall and getting the first person to leave the line and shake hands with all the remaining people in the wall. That's 22 handshakes. The next person can come along and they can shake hands with 21 remaining people stood against the wall. So that's another 21 handshakes. If we repeat this process, then we find that we have 22 plus 21 plus 20 plus 19 and so on, all the way down to the penultimate person who just shakes hands with one other person, so one final handshake. We have the sum of the first 22 whole numbers. When you compute this sum, it turns out that there are 253 pairs of people in the room, which goes some way to explaining why it becomes more likely than not that two people share a birthday when we have 23 people in the room. So this isn't quite the end of the mathematics. There are two options we need to consider. Either two people don't share a birthday, or at least two people do share a birthday. The second of those is harder to compute. So what we're going to look at first is the probability that two people don't share a birthday when we've got 23 people in the room. But again, this is quite hard to compute. So I'm going to start by just thinking about what's the probability that when there are two people in the room that they don't share a birthday. Well, the first person can have their birthday on any day of the year. No problem with that. The second person can then have their birthday on any other day of the year. So that means the probability that they don't share a birthday is 364 divided by 365. But now we don't just have one pair of people in the room. When we've got 23 people in the room, we decided there are 253 different pairs of people in the room. So we have to take this figure, 364 divided by 365, and multiply it by itself 252 more times. And when you do that, you find that 364 divided by 365 to the power of 253 is actually just under a half. This means that the probability that two people don't share a birthday is just under a half, which therefore means that the probability that at least two people do share a birthday is just more than a half. So that goes some way to explaining why, when we've got 23 people in the room, the probability that two people will share a birthday becomes more likely than not. So that's a lot of theory, but does it really work out in practice? Well, at the 2014 World Cup, there were 32 squads, each of which had 23 players, this magic number that we needed to have the probability of two people in that group sharing a birthday being more likely than not. When we go and look at the data, we find that exactly 16 out of the 32 squads at the 2014 World Cup in Brazil had two players or more who shared a birthday. Now, this is probability, so it doesn't always work out this nicely, but in this case, we got the exact number we would expect from the theory. So how does this mathematical theory relate back to the likelihood of coincidences in terrorist incidents? Well, I did some research and I found that between April 2013 and April 2018, there were exactly 39 Islamist terrorist attacks against Western nations. When we plug the number 39, the number of terrorist incidents against Western nations over this 5-year period, into our formula to tell us how likely a coincidence is, we find that the probability that two of these terrorist incidents occurring on the same day of the year is almost 90%. So does two terrorist incidents falling on the same day of the year mean that we should be more scared of terrorist organisations because they're so coordinated and can strike at will? Of course not. In short, we should be far more surprised if two terrorist incidents didn't fall on the same day than if they did. So it turns out that the birthday mathematics of coincidences doesn't support Sebastian Gorka's claims that jihadi terrorists are so organised that they can strike at will. And it just goes to show that it's important to think critically and mathematically when we're analysing the headlines in the newspapers or the claims that come out of the mouths of our politicians. The Maths of Life and Death is a book about the places where maths can have an impact on people's everyday lives, perhaps without them even realising it. You can pick up a copy from all good bookshops.